भगवते वासुदेवाय नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जायामुदीरये नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवतीरुत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्टिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। नमो पंकजनाभाय नमो पंकजमालिने नमो पंकजनेत्राय नमस्ते पंकजांग्रे। ओम अज्ञानतिमिरंध्रस्य ज्ञानांजनाशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः। मुखं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंगयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्रीगुरुदीनतारिणं परमानन्दमाधवं श्रीचैतन्यं ईश्वरं। नमः ओं विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे वांछाकल्पतरूपेश्च कृपा सिंधुवेव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम राम हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम राम हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा, वेलकम टू आवर सेमिनार ऑन आर्ट ऑफ चैंटिंग। This class, which Vrishank Prabhu and Mohit Prabhu have arranged, very grateful to both of you. And I will be discussing a few principles on chanting, and then we can do it a little different this time. Generally, after my class, we take questions, but in this class, we can take questions in between if you have. And you don't have to wait for the end of the class, because I will be stopping at 10 a.m. and I will not be taking questions at 10 a.m. So before that, anytime you feel at a particular point you have questions, you can type them and I'll read it on chat and I'll answer the questions. So thank you. So this topic which I have taken, called Art of Chanting, the first foundation is chanting is not an independent activity. Now, this is, I want to make it very clear. Generally, when we have chanting seminars, we come thinking that if I chant, everything will be all right. That's true. Srimad Bhagavatam says that bhakti is not dependent on anything else. Bhakti is completely independent. Savai pumsam paro dharmo yato bhakti radokshaje ahetukya pratiyata yatma suprasidati. Philosophically, tattva or the truth is Krishna bhakti is not dependent on anything material. This is a truth and we will not doubt it and we will not challenge it and we accept it wholeheartedly. And especially sitting on the Vyasasana and while giving a class, this will be the premise, this will be the foundation. We will fight for it, we will watch for it, we will champion the cause of how bhakti is independent of anything material. So there is absolutely no doubt about it. So that is done. At the same time, because we live in this material world, we have certain challenges. And the biggest challenge is the challenge of balance. The so many roles that we have, so many responsibilities that we have. And because of these roles, responsibilities, duties, and the different goals we have for our different roles, we need to understand that chanting is then one of the many things that we need to do. Unfortunately, devotees go into two extremes. One extreme is, oh, chanting will take care of everything. And saying this, we ignore the need to balance. We ignore the need to take care of our emotional lives, our physical needs. And we just focus exclusively on chanting. And it's not that we actually take shelter of the holy name. It's simply that we depend on the holy name and imagine the holy name to be a crutch or the holy name to solve my material problems. So that is one extreme we go into, that we don't actually take shelter of the holy name, but we depend on the holy name for our material needs, thinking that Krishna has said, bhakti is supreme, chanting doesn't need anything else, this is it. That is one extreme. The other extreme is, we think, oh, I have to balance my life. So we get busy with so many other things that we give second-class treatment to chanting. Therefore, we have to first of all understand chanting is the most important activity for a devotee, but it is not to be treated as independent of our other aspects of our personal lives. So philosophically, and the truth of the matter is, chanting is everything. But practically speaking, we need to take care of our needs. And having made this premise or this foundation, we will now enter the topic called Art of Chanting Hare Krishna. Now, I assume that most of you like chanting or you're interested to chant Hare Krishna, and some of you are chanting 16 rounds every day. I have been chanting 16 rounds of Hare Krishna every day for the last some years. So now, how do we chant in such a way that, you know, we actually experience whatever is promised in Krishna consciousness? Now, when we come new to Krishna consciousness, we hear so many promises. We hear most amazing promises of how chanting Hare Krishna will make us happy. Chant Hare Krishna and be happy. Have you heard this? There is a lot of promises about how Krishna consciousness offers bliss. Krishna consciousness offers ecstatic lives. So these are promises that we have heard so many times. And as we spend years in the movement and we chant, we associate with devotees, somewhere we find a discrepancy between what was promised to us and what we are experiencing in our own personal lives. So how do we bridge this gap? How do we reconcile to the different emotional upheavals that we go through? So that is going to be the challenge. That is going to be the discussion in this seminar, which will continue hopefully next week also. But as of now, let us now understand the first foundation of chanting, how we can make chanting work. What can we do to show Krishna that we want chanting to be top class? We want chanting to give us what has been promised to us when we were new in Krishna consciousness. So how can chanting, basically in simple words, what we are going to discuss is, how can we ensure that chanting Hare Krishna will make us happy? Chanting Hare Krishna is the most wonderful process. So how do we realize this and how do we experience this? This is the topic of discussion. So the first point I would like to begin with is, please know that the foundation of experiencing bliss in Krishna consciousness in general and chanting in particular is humility. Humility means to always acknowledge self. You know, sometimes we think self-effacing is bad. No, a self-effacing quality is good, keeping ourselves in the back. When it comes to holy name, this is the mood. Self-effacing is the mood that Krishna, I am small, I am insignificant. Just like in a love, in a relationship. A man and woman in a relationship. See, your partner is convinced of your love when you have self-respect, definitely, but you're willing to subordinate yourself completely to the desires of your beloved. That is how you win the heart of your beloved. Similarly, when it comes to chanting, when it comes to holy name, our relationship with Harinam, the foundation of this relationship is humility, which means, Krishna, your desire is everything. Krishna, I want to please you. I'm chanting this for you. So humility is the foundation of chanting. So the Art of Chanting seminar that we are doing today is founded on these two principles. The first principle we discussed some time ago, that although Hare Krishna chanting is independent of everything, still we need to practice a life of balance. We need to take care of our physical, mental, and emotional needs as well. That is the first premise. And the second is, we enter a relationship with Holy Name only when we have internalized or we have accepted the principle of humility as the foundation of our spiritual life. And humility is most important because one of the byproducts of bhakti, if we practice bhakti for some years, one of the unfortunate byproducts of bhakti is pride, false pride, that I am great, I am good, because the process of bhakti is very attractive. And we generally, a devotee becomes attractive when he starts chanting Hare Krishna. So people will appreciate you. People will acknowledge that you are practicing bhakti. And because we hear so many times, bhakti is highest, bhakti is wonderful, Krishna is greatest. And because I am connected to Krishna, we start thinking, I am also best, I am also highest, I am also greatest. So therefore, false pride easily slips into our consciousness as we start practicing bhakti. Because we are not pure as yet, and because we are accepting the process of bhakti, pride, or false pride rather, it enters our lives even without our realizing it. Therefore, one has to work hard while practicing Krishna consciousness. And we have to work hard to remain humble. We have to work hard to practice humility. And therefore, chanting Hare Krishna, this is the third principle for discussion today, which we have discussed today, that is, we cannot absolve ourselves of working hard in our Krishna conscious practices. But the first principle is balance. We have to balance, lead a balanced life if you want to chant Hare Krishna nicely. Second, there has to be a foundation of humility. And third is hard work. Hard work is extremely important while practicing sadhana. Now, before we go into the details of the techniques of chanting, which we may actually not even discuss, because this foundation is important, to understand that balance is important, humility is important, and hard work is important. And especially hard work, because we generally think, I've come to Hare Krishna now, I don't have to worry about anything. No, we have to worry about our spiritual practices, because sadhana, what is sadhana? Sadhana is not a name of a girl. Generally, we think sadhana, you know, we may have women by the name of sadhana, puja, you know, bhakti, they were all feminine names. But sadhana, the word means what? Literally, the word sadhana means practice. And practice means basically working hard. And practice means we want to attain perfection. We want to get some goal. Sadhana is for sadhya. Sadhya means goal. Sadhana means practice. We practice so that we can achieve some goal. So we do sadhana so that we can get sadhya. So what is sadhya? So when we consider chanting, as for us, chanting right now is sadhana. Chanting is not our goal right now, although it is supposed to be the goal. All pure devotees, they are waiting to chant. If you ask a pure devotee, why do you chant Hare Krishna? When Srila Prabhupada was asked, why do you chant Hare Krishna? What did Srila Prabhupada say? We chant Hare Krishna so that we can chant Hare Krishna. So for Srila Prabhupada and pure devotees, chanting Hare Krishna is not a means. It is not a sadhana. It is not a practice. It is a goal. It is the end of their journey. It is the perfection of their life. Unfortunately for most of us, right now, chanting is sadhana. Chanting is a practice. So what is the sadhya? What is the goal? The goal is we want Krishna. We want to experience Krishna. We want to give pleasure to Krishna. So sadhana means to achieve the goal, sadhya, and that is Krishna, to experience Krishna. So therefore, when we are practicing sadhana, we need to know that if we do three things, sadhana means three things, practice means three things. Instead of wondering why I'm not experiencing Krishna, you know, why I don't feel Krishna's embrace, why I don't feel love for Krishna, why I'm not happy, you know, these questions come in our minds many times. Instead of worrying about all of that, let us ask ourselves, if we are fulfilling the three criteria of sadhana, if you are doing three things, if you are doing those three things, then rest assured that everything will happen, everything will fall in place. So what are the three things that make, that define sadhana or that define a spiritual practice? First is, sadhana by definition means it's a long time project. It's not a 1 month, 2 week, 3 week. It's not a 6-session course. We may do a 6-session journey of self-discovery course and we may think I've become a devotee, or we may get initiated after 2 years of chanting Hare Krishna. And we may think now I have, you know, now I have a right to experience all the things promised in Krishna consciousness. Sorry, that's not going to be the case, because sadhana means it's a long time project. It could be 40 years. Srila Prabhupada asked, Srila Prabhupada, how many years did it take you to perfect chanting Hare Krishna? Srila Prabhupada said, it took me 40 years to chant purely. That means it's a long time project. It's not a 2 year project or a 3 year project. Sometimes devotees say, Prabhu, I've been chanting Hare Krishna for the last 3 years, but still lust has not gone, or still I feel so weak or whatever. But sir, you are only practicing for 2 years or 3 years. So it's a long learned project. It's a 40 year or a lifetime project. So that is the first criteria of sadhana. And second, sometimes you may think, oh, it's a long project. It's a long overall. I have to spend a lot of time. So let me take a break now. Sorry, this is the second criteria of sadhana. No interruption, no break. Daily chanting. You may not chant a lot of rounds. That's okay. But a daily minimum quota has to be chanted every day. No break. You can't say, oh, today I've got exam, or today I'm, you know, whatever. We can't give excuses. Sadhana means no interruption, and sadhana means long run. So long run project and no interruption is what defines sadhana. And third, most important, is it's a practice when, because, you know, when we hear these two things, it's a long project and no breaks. When we hear these two, the problem that happens is we tend to become mechanical, bored, ritualistic. I know many people who are attached to rituals. They think rituals will guarantee everything. Sorry. If you get trapped by rituals, then you are not fulfilling the third criteria of sadhana, and that is conscious investment of time and energy. Means basically we are conscientious, we are careful to a fault, we are periodically evaluating our motives, our mood, our emotional investment in the process. Of course, we are not obsessive. It's not that every second I'm thinking, am I loving Krishna? Am I offering emotions to Krishna? We're not a psychological wreck. No, that's not what we are. But we are consciously investing our emotions in Krishna. If you do these three things, then we are practicing sadhana. And then the sadhana will give us the sadhya, the goal. So I'll repeat, what are these three? First is, it's a long project. It's a long overall 40-year project. Take it as a 40-year project. Second, there are no interruptions every day. And third, conscious investment of time and energy. So this is the hard work required. So we have discussed, first is balance. Second is humility, importance of balancing our life. Second is humility, and third is hard work. So if we know, if we have these three place things in place, then we are ready for understanding chanting. Otherwise, if these three things are not in place, if this triangle is not in place, then it will be disastrous. Then we'll never experience the benefits of chanting Hare Krishna. You know, I remember many times I've heard people say, Prabhupada said 99% of our advancement is dependent on chanting Hare Krishna. Have you all heard this? It's a very common statement. I've quoted this so many times. 99% of our growth, happiness, spiritual life is all dependent on chanting. So I one day decided, let me find out where it is. So many devotees I've quoted, including myself, and I couldn't find the quote by Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada said 99% of our spiritual life is dependent on chanting. But where did Srila Prabhupada say? Now, everything about Srila Prabhupada is documented and recorded. You know, even his sneezing, even his anything he has done is recorded, documented. We are so pakka in this. But where did Srila Prabhupada, when did he say that 99% is dependent on chanting? If any of you finds that quote, please share it with me. because I didn't find it. And I have seen that devotees, they don't spend 99% of their energy on chanting. I've seen the most balanced devotees, most successful, effective devotees who are making an impact in other people's lives. They are spending quality time in chanting, definitely, but they're also doing other things. So it's exactly not 99%. They are balancing, they're leading a balanced life. And secondly, there is humility. I've seen devotees who are humble, genuinely humble, even if their chanting is not all that externally great, that humility pleases Krishna more than their chanting of so many rounds. And thirdly, they are performing hard work. They are sincere, basically. Sincerity is the key. So these three things are in place, balance, humility, and hard work. Then we can experience Krishna. Therefore, sadhana means these three things. Hard work means these three things. Long run, no interruption, and conscious investment of emotions. And again, I want to repeat, we don't want to be obsessed with chanting. We don't want to be like, you know, I'm chanting, oh, Prabhuji gave a holy name seminar, so I'm going to be chanting whole day now. No, that's not going to work, because, you know, we can't demand from Krishna love of Krishna. We need to engage our propensities. We need to engage our rajo, our passion in Krishna's service. We need to purify our lower modes. You know, if we just sit with the bead bag whole day, we'll definitely get mercy because we are spending time with Krishna. But Krishna will be more happy if we are not running away, if you're not living in denial, and if you accept who we are and honestly take a step forward towards Krishna. You know, when you have a bucket of water, you know, sometimes because of in Western countries, when people have not paid their bills, the municipality does not remove the basic facilities because that is inhuman, but they punish you by giving you a supply of water which is very, very slow. So it simply trickles down and it takes an hour for the bucket to fill. You are kind of frustrated. But when the water is dropping and if you're sitting next to the bucket and waiting and watching, when will it get filled? That's crazy. What you could do is you could keep the bucket there under the trickling, under the tap, and you can do other things and then you can come back, right? Similarly, you know, we can't be like sitting every day, oh, I'm chanting now. Why am I not experiencing Krishna? Where is Krishna? Why am I not happy? I'm not happy now. I want to be happy. Why am I feeling like this? No, wait, relax, 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 relax. That won't happen. Let's keep the bucket under the tap. Means let us chant our rounds. Then let us do the other things needed, physical, emotional, mental, our job, our family. Let us do all the things in balance. Let us be balanced. And let us also chant. And let us lead our lives, understanding that it's a long project for 40 years without interruption, and consciously let us invest our emotions and time and energy as best as we can, and know that the bucket will get filled one day. Let us know that one day our hearts will be filled with Krishna's experience. Therefore, it's very important that we have faith in the long process, not look for quick fixes, not look for immediate gains. And Srila Prabhupada was in Melbourne. One man in the class asked that, oh, Swami, I don't like to come to temple so much, but I like the temple. I like the devotees. I come sometimes. So is that okay if I don't come every day? And is it okay if I don't chant so much? But will I also get the benefits of spiritual practice? This is what he asked. And what a beautiful reply Srila Prabhupada gave. Srila Prabhupada said, it's okay. You come once in a while. When you come, you have added $1 deposit in Krishna account. And then you come next time, again you have added, it's like adding $1. Every time you meet devotees, every time you chant Hare Krishna, every time you engage in devotional service, you have added $1. You have added $1. So then Srila Prabhupada said, one day, very soon, because you're adding deposit every day, you will be a billionaire. It will give a lot of interest, a lot of returns. So Srila Prabhupada gave the example of money to explain to this man that any activity, anything we do in Krishna consciousness will give its benefit. So therefore, it's important that as devotees, we know that we don't get obsessed. We know that we have put the bucket under the tap and we continue. Many times we have an utopian idea. When we are new in Krishna consciousness, we want the process to work very fast. We want everything to fall in place. We want to become pure devotee overnight. It doesn't happen like that. Srila Prabhupada can say in all humility that it took him 40 years to perfect chanting Hare Krishna. How can we expect an overnight change in our lives? No, we need to work slowly. There is a very nice biography on Teresa, not Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa of Calcutta is a controversial personality. I don't want to discuss her. But there is another lady called Teresa of Avila. Now, she is a great Christian saint and mystic. And she writes in her autobiography that how, right, she was like a nun and she was practicing very intense Catholic practices. She says in her biography, in her autobiography, that the first 30 years in the monastery where she stayed, she says, my first 30 years were a life of frivolity and life of distraction and temptations and disturbances. So she writes how first 30 years she didn't experience God. She was actually going through a lot of distractions, temptations, struggle, suffering, and it wasn't the same. So after 30 years, actually Krishna gave her mercy.
That in India? Huh?
Hare Krishna. So after 30 years, Krishna gave her mercy. So the point I'm trying to say is, if such a great Christian mystic saint can go through long periods of dryness, if Srila Prabhupada can say that it took him 40 years to perfect chanting Hare Krishna, how can we claim or demand Krishna to make us a pure devotee overnight? That's not going to happen. Therefore, let us be ready for this long project. Let us be ready for leading a life of balance. Let us know that we need to take care of our physical, mental, emotional, and also spiritual needs. Let us know that humility is the foundation. And let us also know that it requires a lot of hard work and not a frustrating hard work. And our entire focus in our discussion on the seminar is how to make that hard work a happy experience. So that's what we are going to discuss right now. How to make it a happy experience. Srila Rupa Goswami has explained that bhakti can be performed in 64 different ways. And, you know, you could water the tulsi plant, you can do circumambulation of Krishna temple, you can go to holy places, you can do aarti of Tulsi Maharani. There are so, you can take charanamrita, all these are devotional. These all are included within the 64 items of bhakti. And he said out of the 64, five are most important. Like that, he has given us different ways of doing bhakti. And all these 64 items that he has given, they are what is called as Vaidhi Sadhana Bhakti. Sadhana means practice. Bhakti is Krishna, love for Krishna, you know, devotional service. So we are practicing devotional service, but we are practicing Vaidhi. Vaidhi comes from the word Vidhi. Vidhi means rules. So Rupa Goswami has given us 64 rules, 64 ways to practice. And the essence of all of this is, you know, we have to basically accept whatever is favorable for improving our relationship with Krishna, and whatever is unfavorable, we reject it. So like, you know, some people, they get married. You know? Now, marriage is not part of devotional service. And remaining brahmachari is also not part of devotional service. If you see 64 items of devotional service Rupa Goswami has given, there is no mention of sannyas. There is no mention of brahmachari ashram. There is no grahastha ashram mentioned. But why do people get married? Why do people take sannyas? Why do people become brahmachari? Why do they take vanaprastha if this is not mentioned in 64 items of devotional service? Because it is favorable. So somebody getting married, if that helps him chant better, in the sense if that helps him create an environment where he has support, then that is encouraged. Because our bhakti rule is anukulasya sankalpa. Surrender to Krishna means anukulasya sankalpa pratikulasya varjanam. Accept what is favorable for bhakti and reject what is unfavorable for bhakti. So if getting married is favorable for you to practice bhakti, then get married. If taking sannyas is favorable, then you take sannyas. But many times we take impulsive decisions. And that's another subject matter. But Rupa Goswami has given us 64 items. And these rules are not to increase our stress. The 64 items are not to make you stressed out that, oh, I'm not able to practice all the 64. That's okay. Rupa Goswami has said that there are two golden rules if you follow. These are called as the mother of all rules in bhakti. If you follow this, whenever you are confused,
oh, am I doing bhakti properly? Oh, I'm not able to practice bhakti. Oh, there are so many things to do. I'm not finished my, you know, I know somebody who's taken a vow of chanting 10 rounds every day. And that person was so much stressed, I'm not able to chant 10. Oh, I need to chant, I need to complete my rounds. Relax. See, that pressure is good because it helps us improve our commitment to Krishna. But if you're always under stress while practicing bhakti, that is not good because that is anukulasya sankalpa pratikulasya varjanam. That is unfavorable for bhakti. But therefore, Rupa Goswami has given us the mother of all rules. He has given us this golden rule. Please remember this one golden rule. This is the essence of all the 64 items that Rupa Goswami has given. And if we remember this one rule, essential rule, then we are practicing bhakti. And what is this golden rule? Smartavya satatam Vishnu vismartavya na jatu chit sarva vidhi nishedasyur etayor eva kinkara. Smart, always remember Krishna. Smartavya patatam Vishnu. Vismartavya na jatu chit. Never forget Krishna. Always remember Krishna. Never forget Krishna. This is the essence of all rules. This is the mother of all rules. Like, for example, we gave the example of circumambulating temple. If you're circumambulating temple, but you're not remembering Krishna, you're circumambulating because you want to lose weight and you have a target of walking 10,000 steps every day. And then you are walking 10,000 steps. You know, people have this watch and they're measuring if they walk 6 kilometers. But we are also circumambulating, but we have not practiced the essence of all these 64 rules. What is that? Always remember Krishna, never forget Krishna. Let us say you couldn't do circumambulation, but you are telling Krishna, Krishna, I wish I could have circumambulated the temple today, but I could not because my leg is paining. But Krishna, I love you. I wish I could do it. So what you have done now? You have remembered Krishna. But the essence of all the rules and regulations is remember Krishna, never forget Krishna. And why Srila Prabhupada gave us chanting of 16 rounds? Because Srila Prabhupada knew that when we chant 16 rounds, because we are with Krishna for 2 hours, it becomes easy for us to remember Krishna. It becomes easy. This 2 rounds, 16 rounds is not a ritual. The 16 rounds is to help us. Imagine you are spending time 2 hours with some person. So will you not connect to that person at least once or twice in those 2 hours? If you are talking to a person. Similarly, these 2 hours of chanting or 16 rounds Srila Prabhupada gave us because he wants us to practice the essence of all the rules and regulations, which is to always remember Krishna, never forget Krishna. I also gave the example of taking Charanamrit, putting water on tulsi plant. So all these are 64 in the part of 64 items of devotion service. But as I'm taking Charanamrita, if I say, you know, Krishna, Vishnu, Padotakam, Pitra, Shirsa, Daraya, Maham. Oh, this is Krishna, it is your Charanamrita. Thank you, Krishna. So if I'm remembering Krishna, then that has become devotional service. That has become sadhana bhakti. So therefore, the essence of all rules and regulations is always remember Krishna, never forget Krishna. And this will make our life auspicious. This will fill our hearts with joy. And this is the way to resolve all confusions, complications. Sometimes devotees are, you know, always confused. I'm not doing this, I'm not doing that. But are we following this one golden rule? Are we sincerely remembering Krishna? Are we offering our hearts to Krishna? I remember one sannyasi. He was in temple hall and I saw him. I offered full dandavat to him. And he looked at me and he shouted at me. He said, you fool, don't you know that when the altar is open, deities are giving darshan? Don't you know the rule that you should not offer obeisances to anyone? So there is a rule. That is one of the offenses. One of the rules that Rupa Goswami has given us is when you are standing in front of Krishna's deity, we should not offer obeisances to anybody else. That's why after Narsimha Arati, before Tulsi Arati begins, we close the curtain and then we do Tulsi Arati. So and he told me like that, he gave Tulsi Arati also. And if the next time, don't offer me obeisances like that. So he scolded me. So I humbly accepted. But in my mind, you know, I wanted to argue because I knew another rule that Rupa Goswami has given, that whenever you see a pure devotee, whenever you see your spiritual master, you should never hesitate to glorify him. You should immediately glorify him and offer obeisances. That is also a rule. So it is amazing, isn't it? So if you see, both rules are contradictory. So if you see a guru and offer obeisances, so I see a question here in this verse, why the same thing is repeated in different ways. I don't know. हरे कृष्ण विच वर्स स्मर्तव्य पततम विष्णु विस्मर्तव्येन जातोजि सर्वविधिषदासु यते ऑलवेज रिमेंबर कृष्णा नेवर फॉरगेट कृष्णा सो व्हाई द सेम थिंग इज रिपीटेड इन टू डिफरेंट वेज आई डोंट नो बट माय अंडरस्टैंडिंग इज व्हेन यू रिपीट इट बिकम्स एम्फैटिक लाइक द जज सेज ऑर्डर 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 सो थ्री टाइम्स ही बैंग्स हिज थिंग ऑन द टेबल सो इट बिकम्स एम्फैटिक That's why in the holy name we have a verse in the scripture which says Hare Rama Hare Rama Hare Rama Eva Kevalam holy name holy name holy name is the only way Kalo Nasteva 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 Gatiraneta there is no other way there is no other way there is no other way so when somebody hears it you feel oh this is really important so like that so I think that's the reason why the verse the same thing is repeated in two ways that's the answer to your question so coming back to the topic what was I saying this sannyasi I was offering him obeisances. And he was upset because I was breaking a rule. But in my mind, I thought there's another rule that whenever you see a spirit sannyasi, you should offer obeisances and you should glorify. So what do I do? I didn't tell him. I didn't argue with him. I kept quiet. But what I have to tell all of you now is, you see, there is a contradiction. You'll find when you see all the rules and regulations in scriptures, you'll find some contradictions. Srila Prabhupada once said that if you read Hari Bhakti Vilas, which Sanatana Goswami has given us, rules and regulations for practicing bhakti, Srila Prabhupada said, if you strictly follow all these rules, you may not be able to come out of the bathroom. There are so many particulars to be followed. So it's not practically possible. Okay. So what do we do then? There are contradictions. Now next time I see this sannyasi, what do? Do I offer him obeisances or not? So simple. What is the essence of all rules? Remember Krishna always. Never forget Krishna. So next time, when I saw the sannyasi, temple hall, I wanted to offer obeisances. But I didn't. And I said, Krishna, please forgive me. He is your pure devotee. And if I offer him obeisances and respects, I know you will be happy. But he has ordered me not to offer obeisances, Krishna. So I am not offering obeisances. But in my heart of hearts, I offer all respects to him. Thank you, Krishna. So externally, I'm standing like this, not offering obeisances. I'm just bent low. And the sannyasi is also happy. I'm also happy. But in my mind, I remembered Krishna. So that's how, although I'm not following the rule, I have practiced the principle. Or let us say somebody else offers obeisances. So he's thinking, Krishna, you are the Supreme Personality of God and I offer obeisances to you. So he's also remembering Krishna. So it doesn't matter whether you have offered obeisances to this sannyasi or you have not offered. The essence is, are we remembering Krishna or not? So this is the golden rule of sadhana bhakti. Now the problem is, we can't always remember Krishna. Let us say I say, okay, now I'm going to sit down and I'm going to spontaneously remember Krishna. Okay, I close my eyes and I'm going to remember Krishna. Will it happen? Is it possible? What will happen if you sit down like this and close your eyes and I'm going to remember Krishna, Vrindavan pastime? Mind will go all over because mind is a reality that we have to contend with. Mind will not remember Krishna. Mind will remember all objects of enjoyment. Therefore, Rupa Goswami has given us 64 items. He said, you do these things. Do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Do all these things. And you remember Krishna. If you simply sit and try to remember Krishna, it's not easy. Because mind is called mana. And in Sanskrit, human being is called manushya. Mana is there in the word manushya also. Manushya means that being who has to struggle with mana. Mana, manushya. So the human being is a person. You see, animals don't struggle with the mind. Human beings have an evolved mind. So they will always keep struggling with our lower nature. So mana has to be regulated. So manushya means that living entity who regulates his mind. Unfortunately, instead of regulating our mind, we have identified with our mind. And we have identified with our mind so much that we think that I am the mind. Therefore, Srila Prabhupada often said, I am not the body. I am not the mind. So we think, why Prabhupada said that? Because we have identified ourselves as the mind. So when the mind tells us to do something, we are not able to see that as mind telling me to do something. We think I have to do this. Our identity is merged with the mind. So attentive sadhana what we are discussing now, attend art of chanting Hare Krishna. When we are talking about all these three principles of balance, when there is balance, humility and hard work in our chanting of Hare Krishna, means when we are chanting Hare Krishna, we are also leading a balanced life. We are chanting Hare Krishna and we are also humble. We are chanting Hare Krishna and we are also working hard in our sadhana practices. If these three principles, if this triangle is in place, then we can actually separate ourselves from our mind. We can recognize, if these three things are in place, we can know that, oh, right now my mind is demanding this gratification. Instead of saying, I want this, we will be able to say, oh, my mind wants this. We will be able to separate ourselves from our mind and self. And that is victory. Because we have become so absorbed in our mind that we have forgotten that we are not the mind. When there is attention in our chanting, when we did a life based on balance, hard work and humility, which is the triangle of bhakti, sadhana bhakti, then from an absorber, we will become an observer. We will be able to observe our own lives from an aerial view. We will get a more and better perspective to our lives. Therefore, it's important that we actually lead a life centered on balance, hard work, and humility. And then chanting makes sense. So this separating ourselves from our mind is extremely important. And there are many things we could do. We could also begin with simple pranayama practices. All these things help us to chant Hare Krishna. You know, there is a very famous author called Viktor Frankl. He wrote a book in the 1940s called Man's Search for Meaning. He was a psychotherapist and he was a Jew. He was arrested by the Nazis, put in the concentration camp. And I think he was in Auschwitz. And he had a close shave. He survived that concentration camp, the ghettos. And somehow he came out safe. And after that, he wrote this book called Man's Search for Meaning. And one sentence in that book is so striking. And first time I read this quote in Stephen Covey's book, and it has remained in my heart ever since. And it has profoundly impacted me. Please listen to this statement and see how important it is in our lives as devotees who are trying to chant Hare Krishna sincerely. He says, between every stimulus and our response to that stimulus, there is a space. And in that space, we have freedom. And in that freedom lies the secret to our growth, success, and happiness. I'll repeat this statement. These are beautiful statements. Stimulus means that which happens to us, and response is how we respond to that provocation. He says, between every stimulus and our response to that stimulus, there is a space. Means what happens to me and how I respond. If you slap a child, baby like this, the baby starts crying immediately. Means there is no space, there is no gap between the stimulus and the baby's response. But if somebody slaps you on the back, the slap on the back is a stimulus and your response will not be immediate. You will process that slap. You will ask whether it is a friendly pat, whether it is angry. And so there is a space between the stimulus and the response, right? So between every stimulus and response, there is a space. And that is a space of freedom. So how we choose that freedom? That freedom that we choose will determine our success, growth, and happiness. So therefore, when we are attentive, when we lead a life of balance, when we take care of our mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual needs, when we work hard in our spiritual practices, and when we have a genuine humility, then we will be able to create that space between stimulus and response. We will be able to have more clarity and control over our thoughts. And then our sadhana practices will be more effective, and consequently, we'll be able to attract Krishna's mercy better. So having given this understanding or having shared this, now let us go to the most important technique or the most important tool for chanting Hare Krishna, and that is being present, being here in the now. Like right now, I'm assuming you are in the class, you are present. Similarly, when I'm chanting, if I'm present, then there is no greater technique, there is no greater tool than this. Now, the philosophical basis of this being present is explained in second chapter of Gita, text number 66, where Krishna tells Arjuna, Nasti buddhi rayuktasya na chayuktasya bhavana na cha bhavetah shanti ashantasya kutah sukham. That, O Arjuna, if you are not connected to the Supreme, you will never be peaceful. And if you are not peaceful, you will never be happy. Nacha bhavetah shanti ashantasya kutah sukham. So, the nasti buddhir ayuktasya, for the intelligence, the consciousness has to be connected to the Supreme. It has to be in touch with the Supreme. Now, the problem with us is that we have many goals. See, we have many roles. You know, some of you are parents, you are a manager in a company, you are a brother, you are a son. So, we have many goals, many roles. And for each of these roles, we have different goals that we have created. So, what is happening? So, some goals, these goals clash. So, as a father, you may have a goal. As a son, you may have a goal. As a husband, you may have a goal. As a manager, you may have a goal. So, different roles will have different goals. And somewhere these goals will clash. And we have created so many goals. So, what is Krishna saying in this 2.66 verse of the Gita? Is that there may be many goals because of so many responsibilities we have. But beyond all these goals, there is one ultimate goal. And if we invest our consciousness on that ultimate goal, then we'll be able to harmonize all the different goals we have for our different roles. So Srila Prabhupada, in the purport to this 2.66 verse, writes a very beautiful statement that all our disturbance in life is created because of want of an ultimate goal. And this is what Krishna is also saying in this shloka. All disturbance is created because of want of an ultimate goal. See, if we have so many goals, we'll become like a schizophrenic. We'll go crazy because we're trying to harmonize everything. So we need to, Krishna is saying, in all these goals, look for that one ultimate goal, which will help you connect. And once you're connected, then everything will fall in place. Otherwise, we are like a split personality. You know, therefore, what we need is a connection. We need to see the ultimate goal. For the japa time, when we are sitting to chant Hare Krishna, this is the mother of all techniques, the father of all techniques. If I am present, if I am there with Krishna, that means I am connecting to the ultimate goal, which is Krishna. So if I am not present with Krishna when I am chanting Hare Krishna, if I am not connected to the ultimate goal when I am chanting Hare Krishna, how will I be able to see the ultimate goal when I am balancing different roles and different goals? Therefore, in that same purport, Srila Prabhupada writes, Krishna consciousness is a self-manifested peaceful condition. So that means everything becomes peaceful, everything comes in harmony when we are present while chanting. Therefore, we have to be present, otherwise we will become bored. When we are chanting our 16 rounds, we will become bored. And when we become bored, and that the boredom is because we are not present, and why we are not present? Because we are bored. And why we are bored? Because we live in the past or we live in the future. See, as we get older, we live in the past. And as we get, when we are younger, we live in the future. A young man looks at the clock and thinks, why is it going so slow? Why doesn't it go fast? And an old man looks at the same clock and wonders why it is going so fast? Why doesn't it go slow? So there is tamasic, young youth and youth, rajoguna, mode of passion drives us. As you get older, tamoguna gets us, lamentation, hankering. So basically, we are living in the past and the future. Momentarily, we may be in the present when our mind is rushing from past to future, future to past, in between for 1 microsecond, we may be in the present. But essentially, we are not present. And because we're not present, we find Hare Krishna chanting boring and we want to do something else. A simple question, you can ask yourself whether your chanting is great or not. What happens after chanting your kota? You have walked to chant 10 rounds. If you have walked to chant 16 rounds, just ask yourself one question. When you complete your kota, what happens? Do you feel nourished because you completed your kota of rounds? Or do you feel relief? These are two different emotions, relief and nourishment. When you are hungry and you eat food, you feel nourished, right? So similarly, chanting, does it nourish you? Or does it give you relief? Like if you are suffering, in hot, hot sun and you come inside an air-conditioned room, you feel relief. So what does chanting finish, when you complete your japa, what does it feel? Oh, japa was like being in the hot sun, it was suffering. Now I've kept the beat bag. Ah, now I feel relief. Now I've come inside an AC room. So relief. So that means chanting Hare Krishna was a burden. It was like being in the scorching sunshine. So that's not healthy. Relief. Nourishment is different. I was hungry and I got good food. So please let us ask ourselves, I am chanting Hare Krishna. After I complete my chanting quota, I feel relief or I feel nourishment. If I am feeling relief, then we have a lot of hard work to do. And if we are nourished, then we can get more nourishment from this class also and these discussions also. But Gurujan Prabhu and other devotees, His Holiness Satchinandan Swami Maharaj, His Grace Srila Gurujan Prabhu, they all have given us this amazing method of one Mahamantra chanting, being present, because this will help us move from the phase of relief to nourishment in our chanting. Our chanting can make us nourished. And all these struggles can be removed by this one small change, one small trick, psychological trick. In the Japa book, Gurujan Prabhu talks about how we don't have to chant one Mahamantra at a time. He says, just chant one Mahamantra, that's all. Just focus on this one Mahamantra that we are chanting. Like if I'm chanting Hare Krishna, I have my hand on my beat bag and I say Hare Krishna. So when I say, when I make, he uses the word sankalpa. He says, make a sankalpa, which means a resolve. So when I, before, you know, like this is the beads. If I have my beads like this, so I'm chanting. As I'm chanting and I'm moving my beads, I may come to this particular beat. So now I finished the chanting. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Now my finger will go to the next beat. He says, as your finger jumps to the next beat, he says, you make a sankalpa. Sankalpa means resolve. What is the sankalpa? I am going to listen to this one Mahamantra. Sankalpa is not, okay, I'll pause here. I've got a question, interesting. Sonali Mataji has written a question. Nandavar Pranam Prabhuji, what if we feel both nourished as well as satisfied and relieved that you are successful in today's quota? Oh, it's a great question. Well, that means congratulations. You know, like I know a mother who feels happy when her children and her husband eat food that she cooks, and she also feels relieved that she has finished her day's quota. So that's healthy, actually. And that's healthy because, you know, that means there's a sense of obligation, there's a sense of duty we have performed. But if we only feel relief, that is a problem. So relief is good if there is also satisfaction and nourishment. It's like, you know, it's like a mother who is cooking for her husband and her children, and she only feels relief that I finished my cooking. But if she's not satisfied to feed her children and her husband, then there is something wrong in the relationship, isn't it? So just imagine this mother has cooked up food and she's put everything on the table and she says, Mera kaam ho gaya. So then her husband and children say, namak nahi hai, isme spice nahi dala. I don't know. Mera time tha, 9 o'clock cooking karam karne ka, maine kar diya. I finished my job. I am relieved. So that's very bad relationship. But if she is focused also on nourishment and satisfaction, then if there is some difficulty in that cooking, then she will go a little extra, right? She may put the spices or she may do something next time better. So therefore, similar in our relationship with Krishna, if it's only relief, then we don't care to improve our chanting. But along with relief, there is also satisfaction that's very healthy. That means we value our relationship with Krishna. That means we are like that mother, that lady who values a relationship with her children and her husband. Similarly, if we value our relationship with Krishna, we will focus on both. Mainly we'll focus on pleasing Krishna. That was what we discussed in the beginning of today's class. And we will feel both relief also, because there is, you know, that is a sense of obligation, duty. Because you know, pure devotees, they have so many things to do in life. So I've done my quota, so I'm relieved. But it's not relief as if it's a burden. We are also satisfied. You know, we want to serve Krishna. So that's the answer to your question. And before I go into more on this one Mahamantra chanting, which Gurujan Prabhu says, I have another question here. Prabhuji, can you explain about being present with words Hare Krishna Ram versus being present with an emotion which comes while chanting? Yes. I haven't actually discussed about being present as yet, but your question is, you are one step ahead of us. Sundari Gopi Mataji, thank you. I will take your question. If I don't take your question after I explain this point, I have another 10-15 minutes to go. We can take up this question as the first thing in our next class. Okay. I'll first complete this point on chanting, being present. Now, being present, Burujan Prabhu says, is listening to one Mahamantra. So if I'm chanting, like if my finger is in the beads, and if I make a sankalpa, this Mahamantra I'm going to listen. And then sankalpa resolve. And this takes a microsecond actually. I'm going to listen to this one Mahamantra. This is the only Mahamantra that exists for me now. There is nothing else. So having made that sankalpa, having resolved that, I invest all my energy, all my consciousness, all my emotions to listen to one Mahamantra, and that is this one which I'm going to chant now. I'm not resolving to chant this Mahamantra or this one or the next round or the next day's chanting. No, I'm not here to chant even one Mahamantra at a time. No, I am here to chant one Mahamantra, and that is this Mahamantra. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. In fact, Burujan Prabhu is so merciful. He said, okay, don't even resolve to chant one Mahamantra. Just resolve to chant the first Hare of the Mahamantra, Hare Krishna. This Hare, just resolve to chant this one. That's it. Listen to the first Hare. If you listen to the first Hare, then it's like the engine starts and all the coaches in the train move. So if you listen to first Hare of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, then the Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, we listen to all the other syllables of the mantra as well. So Burujan Prabhu says, when he was a young brahmachari in the Tokyo temple in the late 1960s, he was pacing up and down, chanting his japa in the temple hall. And suddenly he listened to the holy name. And when he listened to the words and the experience he went through, he realized what sweetness is there in the holy name. And that's when he realized why Srila Prabhupada said that the key of chanting Hare Krishna, the most important key is listen, listen, listen. Srila Prabhupada said three most important techniques for chanting Hare Krishna are listen, listen, listen. Or being present is the key. So the answer to your question, Mataji, when you're asking being present with the words or being present with emotions. So this is the answer. The syllable, like, you know, the Nirakarvadis, many, they chant Om. The focus is on the word, the syllable, A, U, and Ma, Om, Om. That sound reveals everything. Similarly, it's the syllables, Hare, Krishna, and Ram, which is, sound is the basis of creation. When the universe was created, the primordial, it was sound, there was a sound. So Om is the primordial sound. Hare Krishna is the origin of Om. So Hare Krishna, and when we chant Hare Krishna Rama, when we listen to the sound, this sound will unleash a baggage of emotions favorable for Krishna. Now, that doesn't mean we should not focus on emotions. I know His Holiness Niranjan Swami Maharaj, when I was reading his article on chanting, he says he searches for emotions while chanting. So looking for emotions is healthy. But because we have a thinking disease, we are constantly thinking, 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 and we are addicted to thinking. So our emotions are also contaminated. Therefore, Srila Prabhupada simplified the process for us by saying you focus on listening to the holy name. So when I listen to the Hare syllables, Hare Krishna and Ram, if I can simply focus on that, then automatically all emotions come through, because it's not easy to listen. And because you're connected to the sound of the syllables of the holy name, that connection to the sound helps us enter the world of emotions for Krishna. But if you are finding this listening very dry and boring, and if it's, you are more spontaneously attracted to offer emotions to Krishna, then you can live in the world of emotions. So, the starting step is listen. Shravanam. So this is a answer to your question. I hope I answered it. So we'll continue our discussions on listening to the one Mahamantra. This is the most important technique for improving our chanting. And that is because we are suffering from what is called as a thinking addiction. People have drug addiction. they have alcoholic addiction, and most human beings, including devotees, we have a thinking disease, and that's why we are not present while chanting. I've seen crazy people, we have all seen walking on the road, dressed in a very shabby way, and they're talking to themselves loudly. And we put them in the category called mentally diseased or mad, because they are loud, they talk loud to themselves, and they're also aimless. And to be honest, I sometimes feel I'm non-different from that person, because what he's doing outside is happening inside of me. He may be speaking it out loud to himself, but the same thing is happening inside. You know, mind is constantly chattering, constantly analyzing. But happiness in Krishna consciousness is real. It's a real experience when we are connected to the holy names. So when we gently, but firmly, when we pull the mind back, listening to the holy name, when we listen to Hare, Krishna and Ram, then we are connected with Krishna. And that experience of happiness is real. I have another question here. You said we have to listen to the syllables of the Mahamantra. But since my mind wanders, I try to bring back my mind by focusing on Krishna's pastimes or lotus feet. Is this okay? This is excellent, Mataji. Kalpana Mataji has asked this question. That when I try to listen to the syllables, my mind wanders a lot. So is it okay if I if I focus on Krishna's pastimes or lotus feet? I answer this question. But I also quickly take another question from Rishan Prabhu. In our personal experience, being present in chanting is difficult, whereas being present is easy when we are hearing a class or in kirtan or deity dressing. Yes, I'll answer both these questions and then we'll continue the discussion next week. Regarding Kalpana Mataji's question about trying to focus on bringing the mind back by listening to Krishna, focusing on Krishna's pastime, the lotus feet, that is excellent. Remember a bullseye. Have you seen bullseye? You know, they shoot an arrow to the point. So, but before you hit the bullseye, you make a circle. And then first try to shoot within that circle. Actually, what we first do is we make a big circle. And we shoot and try to hit within that circle. Once you become an expert in shooting in that circle, then you make a smaller circle within that big circle. Then your entire focus is on shooting your arrow inside that smaller circle within that big circle. Once you become an expert in shooting an arrow inside that smaller circle, then you make even smaller circle within that circle. And then you focus on that small circle. Then another small circle. Then another small. So finally you hit the bullseye, right? Similarly, for us, the bullseye, Srila Prabhupada said, is listen to the holy name, because that holy name will reveal everything. Everything auspiciousness will happen if we hit the bullseye, if we listen to the holy name. But for that to happen, we need a big circle first. So if your big circle is remembering Vrindavan Dham, if your big circle, I know Kalpana Mataji, she is always about holy places. She goes to all the yatras, to Vrindavan, Jagannath Puri. So if you are spontaneously attracted to Dham, Krishna's pastime, Krishna's lotus feet, that's okay. But please know that that is like the big circle. And eventually you want to come inside and connect to Krishna's holy name. So so does that answer your question? I hope it answers. So that's perfectly okay, because we are doing all of this to come closer to Krishna. And regarding Vrishank Prabhu's class, being present is easy when we are hearing class or kirtan or deity dressing, but being present is difficult while chanting. Now, this is a very beautiful question. I think this is a common problem with all of us. And why this? Now, I don't know whether your question is why it happens or what to do about it. I think it is both.
It's now, both,
right? So I'll tell you why it happens. Then we'll discuss how to resolve this. Why it happens is very simple. When you're deity dressing, you're doing something. Okay. And class is attractive because there are many things, many points spoken. Some joke may come up. You don't know what's coming up when you're hearing a class. In deity dressing, you're doing something. In kirtan, there is pleasing melody, music pleasing to the ears. Now, chanting is difficult, and it is difficult to be present because it is the same monotonous activity externally. If you're learning karate, if you're playing tennis, there is action. There is excitement. There is thrill. But chanting is the same. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. There is not much excitement. There is not much happening. And because of that, we are like kind of bored. It's difficult to be present. That's the reason. I hope the why is clear. Now, how to resolve this. How to resolve this? Now, for that, this one mahamantra is the most amazing technique, and this entire seminar is about that. Next class also we're going to discuss how to ensure that chanting Hare Krishna can be as exciting as playing tennis or practicing karate or DT dressing, or how it can be. That's what we are discussing. And that's our entire seminar about. One mahamantra is one way to begin. Let's focus on listening to one mahamantra. So maybe if this doesn't work, there are other techniques also which we will discuss. But it is natural because not much physical activity happening while we are chanting. It's all more about the mind and the emotions. Therefore it's difficult. But it's possible to work on it. But don't get too worried about it, Vrishank Guru, because it's a common problem. Most of us chant Hare Krishna as a duty, as an obligation, not spontaneously. And this duty and obligation is also a sign of love. So even though you don't feel great ecstasy, but if you keep doing your duty of chanting your fixed quota of rounds every day, I'm sure over a period of time, we will be able to experience the same excitement in chanting as we experience in hearing a class or worshipping the deities. So is that okay, Prabhu? Can we go to the next question? We'll take one more question and then we'll continue next time. We usually prioritize everything else other than chanting Hare Krishna, and at times push chanting to end of the day. We usually prioritize everything else other than chanting Hare Krishna, and at times push chanting to the end of the day. How can we correct this habit? Oh, simple way, Mohit Prabhu, simple way we can correct this habit by prioritizing chanting and pushing all other things to the end of the day. So, Stephen Covey does this exercise in his seminars. He used to do, of course, he's no more now. You take a big jar, big glass vessel, and he would put, he would fill it with sand. And then he would ask the audience to put water, and the water would be full. And then he would get rocks, and then he would say, put rocks inside. No, rocks will not be, you can't put the rocks because water and sand and water is already filled there. But then he removes all of it. Then the second, again, they put the same glass vessel. And then first he says, put those rocks. So then the rocks are put. Then all that sand is put, somehow it's adjusted. And after all the sand is put, then the water is put. So he proves how, if you put the big rock first, then the sand and water can be accommodated. But if you put sand and water first, then the rock cannot be put. Similarly, here, in your example, chanting Hare Krishna is the big rock, and the sand and water is other duties. So what you have done is, you have filled your day with sand and water. So in the end, that big rock, there is no place. The day is like that glass vessel. One day is like one glass vessel. So why not begin the day? Why not put the big rock of chanting Hare Krishna inside the vessel called the day? First, you put that rock, then everything else you will be able to adjust. That is what is the answer to your question. Is that okay, Mohit Prabhu? Okay. Now, Mansi Mataji has one last question. Hare Krishna Prabhuji, very often while listening and delishing Hare Krishna mantra in the emotional wave of love for Krishna, we also fall for thinking about life's miseries often only while chanting. How do we curb this cycle? No, I think don't think too much about it. Lot of emotions come, lot of thoughts come about miseries, about difficulties. Like it all pass. Don't worry too much about it. Just listen to the holy name. That's what Gurujan Prabhu says. Just keep listening. Thoughts will come, thoughts will go. Don't see that thinking about our thoughts is also mind tricking us. So life's miseries, thoughts will come. Sometimes, when I'm chanting, I get a lot of ideas for giving classes. Today I was chanting in temple hall. I had to consciously tell myself, I'm not giving class today at 8:45. No class. Otherwise I start thinking about what to speak in the class. So mind is always saying many, many things. So we will continue our discussion next week. It is 10 o'clock. I have to rush for something else. I deeply appreciate all of you participating. We have done part one of this seminar called Art of Chanting Hare Krishna. We'll continue our discussion next week. I'll deeply appreciate if you come prepared with the review of today's class. If you have some summary or if you remember what we've discussed today. And then that will help me also because I spoke many things spontaneously. In fact, the whole class was spontaneous. So if somebody can summarize what we discussed, especially the three foundational principles of balance, humility, and hard work. And if somebody can summarize today's class, and then we can start with next week's session. Thank you very much. My sincere gratitude to Rishank Prabhu and Mohit Prabhu for organizing today's class. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Krishna.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.